A bordo, no lo rompas.
Bueno, adiós.
Sí, con la ropa en saldo. A huge benefit to fertility doctors. Nowadays we see fertility is also increasing in a greater trend as other diseases, and gonadotropin has actually made a great difference in the people who want to conceive. And see, ovulation induction is a prime important factor for gonadotropins. The understanding between the hypothalamus, the pituitary and the gonads actually plays a very important part in altering our therapy with gonadotropins. The hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis just gets developed when the patient attains puberty. And the modification in these three lines is the most important factor where gonadotropins act. Generally, this is an important thing. See, when they did a pituitary transposition, they took the pituitary out of its shell and put it near the renal tissue. And when they did that, they lead this to the gonadal failure. But they when repositioned it to its original position, they found out that the gonadal activity was re-established. So this denotes there is something between the hypothalamus and the gonads which is actually influencing the fertility. And that was the hormone called as gonadotropins. So the key concept of a menstruation and a normal fecundity is a GnRH pulsatile secretion. It has to be in a critical frequency and an amplitude for them to produce an egg and also produces menstruation. This GnRH pulsatility is actually in a plateau stage before the girl attains a menarche. Once the pulsatility increases with the critical, the word critical is very important, with the critical frequency and amplitude, the whole thing starts off. The hypogonadal, pituitary, gonadal axis got stimulation and the menstruation occurs. So, ovulation induction, what do we really want? Whether we want a single egg or a multifollicular development, and what are the complications associated, and what is a novel protocol that will suit many people with less complications. So initially, we used to give clomiphene citrate for a person who is just comes with a history of fertility. The dosage is about 50 to 100 milligrams. We can start it on the day 2, 3 or 4. The starting dates are very important. This is the time when the initial stage of the gonadotropin pulsatility increases. The ovulation is usually detected by ultrasound, basal body temperature and LH kits. And when these facilities are not there, a day 21 progesterone will see whether our drug has really worked. That is, the day progesterone levels will show increased level if she has ovulated. Generally, how does this clomiphene citrate act? It's an estrogen agonist and an antagonist. Two types of activities is done. So it acts as an estrogen agonist in the peripheral tissues. So the estrogen is less. Once the estrogen is less, there's a negative feedback effect. And the GnRH again secretes an increased amplitude and leads to follicular development. So unexplained infertility. What is unexplained infertility is the patient comes to you, husband and wife. You have tested everything. The tubes are normal. The ovaries are normal. She's normally ovulating. The husband's count is normal. There's no problem in having intercourse. Those people you explained as infertility. In those people, when you just give them clomiphene citrate, they, along with metformin and IUI, IUI is intrauterine insemination, it increases the pregnancy rate. This was done with 17 trials of meta-analysis by Hughes in 2000, which shows that it increases. In some patients who have no IUI ovulation, clomiphene citrate in all doses is associated with increased pregnancy rates. So when the patient is actually resistant to clomiphene citrate, you are giving her 6 months of continued use, still she is not ovulating, then you know that you have to change the drug. So either you increase the dose or increase the duration of the treatment or you add HMG. So nowadays a novel drug which has come is letrozole. Initially it was banned for some years, but now it has come into practice. generally the androgens in our body gets converted to estrogens. Letrozole inhibits this, so it's an aromatase inhibitor. So when the estrogen levels are less, again it has a negative feedback effect, leading to increased DNRH secretion with increased amplitude, and the ovulation occurs. The most important advantage of letrozole is it has a single follicle, so no risk of multiple pregnancies, and the endometrium is not affected because it doesn't have any antagonist properties. Letrozole is commonly used by other physicians and oncosurgeons for treating breast cancer. Tamoxifen, as we all know, is also useful for treating breast cancer. There is no significant benefit over tamoxifen over clomiphene citrate. So what are the combination therapies you can add is, we can use clomiphene with metformin and N-acetylcysteine or in CC-resistant cases. And suppose you don't find any other therapy which is more important is ovarian drilling. See, metformin is something which we and our diabetologists share in common. Generally, in persons with PCO, it's mostly a metabolic syndrome where the insulin levels are very high but they are not working. So metformin, how it reduces diabetes, the same way it reduces the insulin level in PCOS patients. So nowadays we see many gynecologists prescribing this anti-diabetic drug for people who don't consume. So what practice? We can use a timed intercourse or artificial insemination of the husband's sperms. Generally the common practice which we can use is clomiphene citrate or our gonadotropins which is HMG or FSH. And what is your aim should be is the protocol which you take should give us good results and avoids complications. The most suitable protocol, the best protocol and to avoid complications should be the norm when we are using gonadotropins. So when we are coming for IVF treatment, which we see many of them undergo, these are all, you can see lot of follicles there, each one will have an egg. So we have a multiple follicular development here. For this we cannot give CC or letrozole, we need to give gonadotropins, which is an integral part in the ovarian stimulation. So there are many protocols which I don't think will be interesting for you people. There are two protocols which we use HFG. Which we use antagonist or agonist protocol. This is all altering the DNRH ratios, that is amplitude and the frequency. That is the way how we practice so that we get more multifollicular development for IVF. So gonadotropins. So initially when during 1950s and 1960s they used to extract the urine from the postmenopausal women, mostly nuns from a particular convent in Italy. When you take those urine from this postmenopausal women and which has FSH and luteinizing hormone, when injected into people who are anovulatory, they started becoming pregnant. So that is the reason how HMG was, that is human gonadotropin menotropins was discovered. Then coming after 40 years was FSH, where the LH was removed by immunoassay and we got the urinary FSH. Then came the recombinant technology, where instead of having only the urinary proteins, we had a recombinant proteins which had alpha and beta units of FSH, which has more estrogen secretion with less half-life. The batch-to-batch consistency was good and free from urinary proteins. Now the latest we have is something called as porifollicotropin. It has only a specific unit of FSH and is only a weak dose. Generally, gonadotropins are given daily, subcutaneous, sometimes BD dose. This is a new one where the patient can take a weekly dose, one dose every day. So starting dose, how much gonadotropin to how much we have to give depends upon the age. Age weight is a very important factor in our fertility area. The weight of the patient, and usually we give 3 ampules subcutaneous and an average weight woman about 60 kgs. And protocols, see, always it is the GNRH, that's gonadolaxis, how we play with it, that gives us how the gonadotropin works. In agonist protocol, we use a downregulation protocol. In short protocol, we use a flare-up effect. And advantages is, we use a shorter period, reducing time for GNRH, and reducing the amount of the drug used. The long protocol is, when you keep on giving gonadotropins to a patient, she actually desensitizes. The ovary, the pituitary doesn't respond. So she is downregulated. She becomes hypogonadotropic. Then you add exogenous gonadotropins, which will cause follicular growth. It is more expensive, more longer time, larger doses of the drug, but pregnancy rates are really high. So when we compared about 22 patients who underwent two different protocols, we found the superiority of the long protocol, which is considered as a gold standard. Ultrasound protocol is only for 3 days we give the stimulation using increasing the amplitude of the GnRH gonadal axis and increasing the follicle development. So when we have a poor responder, you give large doses but still she doesn't respond, we can use a clomiphene, HFG and an antagonist protocols. So generally gonadotropins are easy to use, only thing we need to play with how we have to modify the gonadal axis, but it's an expensive treatment because these are all exogenous gonadotropins. And we add LH supplementation, luteinizing hormone supplementation, so that we get good number of eggs because each egg has to give rise to good quality embryo. These studies shows that LH supplementation is required. The most important way how our gonadotropin works is live birth rate per woman. How whether this gonadotropin has worked for her or not depends upon whether you get a single baby or a double baby. And effectiveness depends upon the new millennium, whether the recombinant versus the HPHMG shows that they both has a normal weight. So adding LH to a normal stimulation shows that it actually improves the implantation rates also, because it has a little HCG in its component which helps in implantation. So and when we use the gonadotropins, there is no increase in the spontaneous miscarriage rate and multiple pregnancy rates are pretty higher when we use gonadotropins. So the future of fertility in managing gonadotropin is, we have to down-regulate the patient with GnRH but with a lower risk of OHSS. So complications of using gonadotropin is OHSS, that is we call as ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, and multiple gestation. In ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, we get large fragile ovaries and there's a lot of third space collection. So we get hemoconcentration leading to oliguria. The third space collection gives rise to ascites and pleural effusion, which has to be done corrected meticulously. So the complication of ovarian stimulation drug, the most important where you expect a mortality sometimes that occurs in fertility treatment is OHSS. So generally when there are lots of number of follicles and we expect a OHSS, what we do is we prevent ovulation by using a posting technique where we withdraw the hormones for about few days, or we withhold the ovulation drug that is called HCG. So we nowadays come to a novel protocol which will actually benefit many people, where you initially give HMG and then add the clomiphene citrate, get only 2 or 3 dominant follicles and have a single healthy pregnancy. So this protocol is especially suitable for young women, for those with unexplained infertility. It is also suitable for PCOS women which avoid the risk of OHSS. It is simple, safe and appears to be cost effective. So the take home message for gonadotropin is, we have to have a monofollicular development with clomiphene citrate and a multifollicular development with HMG and antagonist. Complications like OHSS should be prevented, and novel protocol suitable for many patients which will use HMG or CC. After all, motherhood is a gift. Thank you.
How much does this cost for a protocol?
It depends upon the type we are using, sir. Suppose we use a urinary gonadotropin, the price comes to around 700. The same, when we use a recombinant, it comes to about 3000.
No, the whole package for...
It depends upon how much dosage they take. Some people, depends upon the age. Suppose you are using only 3 ampules, the total cost will come to 45 to 50 doses.
Thank you very much for a wonderful talk. Now we move on to the next topic of recent advances in surgical oncology by Dr. Saravanan, PDCMF, Sims Hospital. Please move on.